John's chapter. Let us listen for God's word. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. This is the word of the Lord. Well, I have decided this morning that what we need to do, we need to have a foot washing ceremony this morning. I think that's what we need to do. We have a lot of folks that have been really busy lately. They've been out handing 450 door hangers. They've been out working at the Samaritan with food, been working in the kitchen, cleaning it up, getting it all spruced up for both the church and for the community. We have a lot of people that have been doing some yard work, digging up dandelions. We have people that have been organizing Easter egg hunts. We have people that have been working with youth. A lot of people have been doing a lot of work. So we need to have a foot washing ceremony. Because did you know that the average foot gives off a quarter cup of perspiration a day? Quarter cup. That's on a slow day. If you're doing a bunch of fancy footwork like we've been doing around here lately, that's a whole full cup. One full cup of perspiration on your feet. So I think a foot washing ceremony is really good, don't you? Don't you think that would be workable? Yeah. Yeah, I see you running for the doors too. Yeah. You don't believe me, I'm sure, that that's how much your feet perspire. So I suggest that maybe you take off one shoe and you pass it to someone on your left. Take off a shoe and pass it to your neighbor. Let your neighbor take a whiff. Yeah. Case closed, huh? Yay, Bobby's over there doing it. No matter what kind of running we do in our life, our philosophy has become this. We really don't want to sweat. We may have to keep pace with a frantic world, but we really don't want to feel it. Don't want to feel it. And maybe that is why shoe manufacturers are now turning to what are called comfort technologists. Yeah, comfort technologists who have researched various shoe linings in hope of discovering greater breathability to help that muddy buildup. Now, while the foot in the average shoe might create serious Louisiana bayou conditions, these newly developed linings allow better air circulation, create conditions that are more akin to, say, maybe a summer day in North Dakota. Yet in the gospel passage that Barbara read, we hear there was a lot of frantic running around in those early days after the resurrection. A whole lot of sweating was going on. You know, Mary Magdalene hysterically ran to the disciples upon discovering that the stone was rolled away from Jesus' tomb. Peter and the other disciple dutifully ran to the gravesite to see for themselves. And then they returned home, no doubt sweating out the possibilities about what could happen to their Lord. Mary, she remained sweating it out and weeping in the garden. The men returned home, later meeting behind locked doors, sweating it out again for fear of the Jews and wondering what was going to become of them. The disciples eventually did see Jesus, and when Jesus spoke those words on the very first Easter, they surely made the disciples sweat, if not quake, in their sandals. We heard what Barbara read. Jesus said, "Peace be with you." Whereupon he immediately engaged them in this touchy-feely interactive experience, showing them his pierced hands and bloody torso, inviting them to see and to touch. Again, he said, "Peace be with you." And he talked about painful stuff like forgiveness and retaining sins. And then there was a third time Jesus said, "Peace be with you." It was a week later, and he made Thomas touch his seeping wounds. "Put your hand in my side," Jesus suggested. "Put your hand in my side." How gross is that? But faith can be gross, and faith can be sweaty and decidedly unpeaceful. Following Jesus may involve blood, sweat, and tears. When we walk in faith, we may not experience nice, airy breathing. And I know the evangelism committee's going, "No, don't say that. Don't tell them that, Pastor. No, no." But believing in Jesus is not a walk in the park. Even from the very beginning, the walk for Christ's disciples has been challenging. But when our 21st century world excitedly contacts comfort technicians to make life's sweaty routine disappear, we seem to perpetuate the idea that discomfort is to be avoided at all costs. We seem to believe that life, like our shoes, can appear to be fashionable while feeling like sneakers. But truth is, sometimes life is uncomfortable. And that was the understanding to which the Acts passage I read spoke. Sometimes life is just uncomfortable. What would you call a group of people who share their cars, share their clothes, share their couches?
Hippies! Yes.
And their computers. Hippies. But could they be called Christians? Could they possibly be called Christians? The book of Acts tells us that the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul. And no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. In first century Jerusalem, the members of the church shared what they had with each other. They were trying to build a sharing society. Now, unfortunately, we don't have many positive examples of common ownership. But for a brief moment, in the first century, Christians held everything in common, and the result was that there was not a needy person among them. They were creating a God-loving community that valued people above possessions. Christians shared because they wanted to share. They discovered that common ownership actually helped them to achieve their personal goals. The same is true today, as many people rediscover the value of sharing in some surprising ways. Zip cars are now available in a number of cities, and these cars, you can rent these cars, and you can drive them by the hour or by the day, and that includes gas and insurance. And we know about Uber and Lyft. There's an alternative to taxis. How about couch surfing? Do you know about couch surfing? Yeah, it allows you to surf on couches around the world as you travel, staying as a guest in someone's home on their couch. Bike share puts thousands of bicycles at your fingertips. Share desk that offers rentals of short-term, affordable, flexible office space and Airbnbs. But is all of this sharing really practical? Is it really practical? I think if we were to turn back pages of history, we might see this solidly in our past, as was just told to us. Those hippies, that psychedelic 60s, that era which Linda Knight, Mike Wyatt so beautifully portrayed at the Fondue Bingo Night recently. You know, people shared their lives and possessions in this communal living craze. It was the era of tune in, tune on, drop out. And our parents back then, they knew civilization as they had known it was gone. And yet, the tie-dye idealism and bell-bottom open-mindedness was based not in the button-down, uptight refinement of successful parents, but found in the back pages of the Bible itself. Today we think we're self-sufficient and we don't need to depend on anyone. But Scripture shows us our souls are designed for sharing. And Jesus fit in with that crowd of the 60s. He looked the part. Long hair, beard, sandals, drinking wine, wild-eyed with compassion. He worked against the establishment. He preached for the people. When he called, people followed. 12 became his most intimate associates. Yeah, his death was a momentary speed bump, but the resurrection powered up the movement again. When he departed, his followers lived according to the spirit of his message. They shared and they cared. And herein lies the message that comes from this early community of Christians in Acts. In a true and faithful Christian community, no one is left behind. No one is lost. No one is hungry. No one is cold. And all are welcomed at Christ's table. All are welcomed at Christ's table. And such a lifestyle is not possible unless there is leaving and weaving. The first disciples left their homes and occupations and followed Jesus. The early church left behind their religious traditions, family expectations and security, and risking their very lives, shared openly and freely of what they had with each other. Discipleship is not possible without leaving. Leaving yesterday, leaving excuses, leaving we've always done it that way. To be a sharing community of faith, we must be willing to leave our comfort zones, leave behind materialistic values, perhaps abandon traditional notions, if we're going to be the compassionate community Jesus envisioned the church to be. The leaving motif was predominant among those hippies of the 60s and 70s. They fled everything. They called it dropping out. But maybe we can learn a thing or two from them here in 2018. Maybe. The communes of that area, by and large, are gone. The church, too, is in danger of losing the sense of leaving the world and its values, and instead has become joiners, adapting, imitating, aping the culture in an effort to be relevant, forgetting that it is more important to be real than to be relevant. Compassionate discipleship is not only impossible without leaving, It also requires weaving. And the lesson here is that we are not self-sufficient. We cannot live independently of each other. And this is both a privilege and a responsibility. Theologian Bonhoeffer notes that Christians are privileged to live in visible fellowship with other Christians. It is by the grace of God that a congregation is permitted to gather visibly in this world to share God's word and sacrament. For the most part, in our supposedly self-sufficient society, we've forgotten about caring for each other today. Fact is, we are not self-sufficient. Never have been, never will be. Self-sufficiency is a fantasy based in American mythology. We need one another. We need one another. We'd all be better off if we depended even more on each other. Not dependence, not independence, but strength and faith through interdependence, interweaving, a spiritual weaving that knits our souls and our lives together. Christians are communal beings. It's the foundation of our belief. The bearded and sandaled Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to the one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." Communes of the 60s may have disappeared, but Christian community and compassion have not, or should not. It's just going to require our leaving some things and weaving together other things, as well as our spirits with one another. Stand. This is the table of our Lord Jesus Christ, and all who profess belief in him are invited to this table. This is not a Presbyterian table, but a table for the children of God, all of the children of God. Join with me in the invitation to the table printed in the bulletin. The resurrection has begun. The day of celebration is here.
Hallelujah.
We gather at the table to share in the banquet of life.
Here we meet all who share with us the hope for a brighter future.
All who wish to follow the way of life are welcome to eat and drink at God's table.
Let us eat together.
Here at this table.